Today we're talking about passenger pigeons and the comeback of the century.
Pigeons.
I love pigeons. So,
have you heard of passenger pigeons ever?
I've heard of pigeons.
Prior to like the 1850s, on the North American continent, there were somewhere between 3 and 5 billion passenger pigeons. They were by far the most populous bird in North America, possibly up to like a third, maybe a half of all of the birds.
Wow.
And probably the most populous bird in the world.
Wow.
So they had a tactic known, like a survival tactic known as predator satiation. This is periodical cicadas also do this. You know, they appear in huge numbers every 13 or 17 years, and they're just too many to be eaten. They're just way too many to be eaten, and their predators, you know, don't have enough food in the meantime for it to be worth their numbers expanding so much to survive just off the cicadas.
So they just get full up and leave the rest of them alone.
Yeah, yeah. Passenger pigeons, similar. There were flocks of like that were 1 mile wide and 40 miles long. They would take hours or days to pass overhead.
Wow.
Yeah. Wow. Wowza. That is a lot of pigeons.
A quote from 1806 sighting. In about 15 minutes, my men knocked on the head and brought on board about 300. The most fervid imagination cannot conceive of their numbers. The noise in the woods was like the continued roaring of the wind, and the ground may be said to have been absolutely covered with their excrement.
Oh, so you don't want to be standing underneath a cloud of 5 billion pigeons, or you'll get covered in their crap.
Yeah, indeed. But this didn't last long, having lived for approximately 6 million years in North America. I think we can kind of guess how this came to an end. The previous quote gives something of a clue to that. They were, you know, quite easy to kill, especially the young, which isn't great for the survival of a species if you're just killing all of the young ones all the time. And also just large-scale deforestation and destruction of habitats across North America. So they went down from a population of somewhere between 3 and 5 billion in the 1850s, and by 1900 or 1902, depending on who you listen to, there were none left in the wild.
Wow.
Bad time to be a pigeon.
Guess how the last ones popped their clogs.
Oh, no, they ran into it, flew into a wall.
Killed and stuffed. Of course.
You like, genuinely wouldn't think that would be possible.
To kill 5 billion things. I mean, I wouldn't put it past human beings, let's be fair.
Habitat destruction also played a big role, but also just they were considered so numerous, even till the 1890s, they were considered so numerous that it was just inconceivable that anything like this could have happened.
Right.
And this it's believed that the extinction of the passenger pigeon essentially rescued bison, because their population numbers were also so low, but this was like the beginning of some conservation efforts, which wasn't enough to save many dwindling species, but like, yeah.
I guess as well, once they'd killed so many, then their like survival tactic of just masses, like massive numbers against predators isn't as effective anymore, and like they can be picked off by other things as
exactly,
well.
Exactly. They benefit from the alley effect, which is exactly that. So once individuals in larger groups have a greater chance of survival for a bunch of reasons.
Right, like shoals of fish and things. Yeah.
Up to a point.
Yeah.
The last known passenger pigeon, a female named Martha, possibly named after Martha Washington, died in Cincinnati Zoo in 1914.
Wow.
But that is not the end of the passenger pigeon story.
De-extinction.
because now we have to talk about de-extinction. Passenger pigeons are the poster child for the de-extinction movement. They became extinct recently enough that they're still like on the minds of lots of people. In North America, they also had a huge, obviously, in such enormous numbers, they had a huge impact on their environment. And one of the struggles with conservation efforts is you both need to prepare the environment for the animals, but you also need the animals to prepare the environment. If that makes sense.
So you wouldn't want them to just appear. You wouldn't want 5 billion pigeons to appear again, because then all of a sudden, an environment that's for 100 years not had any pigeons now has 5 billion pigeons.
Right. Well, exactly.
And that's also, you could just put 5 pigeons back out into the wild because they wouldn't survive either.
They wouldn't survive. Yeah.
It's like in the Avengers when they unsnap people. That's like 4 billion people suddenly appearing back into existence. It doesn't work.
But also, the habitat isn't there for them anymore. Part of the reason they weren't... many of the factors involved in their extinction still exist. Even if there would be, like, an awareness that overhunting is not a great idea.
Yeah.
So, how would de-extinction work?
Get the DNA in it.
There are
a handy DNA,
but that's an easy thing to say now.
DNA into a regular pigeon egg, easy.
Yeah, you just got to inject pigeon DNA into a frog.
I'll tell you a little bit more about exactly how they do it in a minute. But other de-extinction attempts, including European cattle, that is the ancestor of current cattle. They're trying to reverse breed it between existing breeds of cattle to try to reproduce the extinct species.
Surely that's just a different animal that's basically the same.
Well, the guy who I heard talking about this, who I'll leave a link to his TED talk in the description, actually, because I think he's a big name in the field. His argument was, it's not going to be perfect, but nature's not perfect anyway. and you could argue, if they're providing that kind of environmental function, which is to say grazing meadowland in ways that affect the kinds of habitat that can exist for other creatures, then that's a good thing anyway.
So they're looking to bring back this species to serve like an ecological function.
Yeah, and also obviously there's the thing of people care about animals and the extinct ones hold a place for people. But yes, it is that as well. You know that in the fens where we grew up, most of that kind of fenland environment is wetland environment. It doesn't really exist anymore, but there are a few pockets of it. And there used to be a kind of deer that lived there. And because that deer went extinct, they brought in Chinese water deer
with the tusks
instead to do that, to serve that same purpose. But passenger pigeons, how would they do it? From this talk that I watched, it goes something like this. You get some DNA from a passenger pigeon. This DNA is broken and old and difficult to work with, but you work with it anyway. You get its closest living relative, a different kind of pigeon, and you try to figure out what are the most important parts of the passenger pigeon genome and kind of add those into the existing pigeon genome. Yeah, there's a lot of... This is, again, coming back to it's not perfect, but it's not perfect anyway. They find the parts that they consider to be the important parts and they paste them in. Mm-hmm. And then what they do with these is they somehow, in a way that I don't understand, splice them into chicken embryos. And then the chickens grow up with the reproductive organs of a passenger pigeon. So they're chickens, but their reproductive organs are passenger pigeon.
They don't even use organs. They don't even use the pigeon to actually...
No. No.
What?
No, but they... So the chickens lay the eggs, and then those... So they are surrogated by a different kind of pigeon, which aren't going to have all of the same...
Pigeon or the chicken egg.
Yeah. And this is not a perfect... It's not a perfect, like, parenting relationship.
Because yeah, it sounds really weird.
Passenger pigeons have like, behaviours that are specific to themselves, but they think it will probably be fine because bird behaviours are kind of, to a large extent, ingrained anyway.
Could they not have it raised by pigeons?
Will have it... It's born to chickens, sorry. It's raised by pigeons.
Right.
But passenger pigeons were unique in their in their huge flocks.
Yeah.
I knew this sort of weird, crazy stuff would happen if they passed gay marriage.
I think they've done this with falcons. I think it's done. I think they've done it, but not with an extinct species.
Right, so like have a chicken lay an egg that's a falcon egg and then raise the falcons with other falcons.
Yeah.
Wild. Because they want more falcons? Like was that why? Or were just testing if they could do it?
Got some falcon DNA, don't ask how I got it, I just have it. Got some chickens, don't ask how I just got them. Gonna together and then voila a chicken
so
pigeon pie
no obviously
bibbidi babbidi boom we got some chicken pie.
Obviously the extinction has its critics. There's plenty of people who bring up exactly the point that you raised earlier, which is okay, but what happens if you actually reintroduce these species? They are going to push out other birds. They're going to drastically change the ecosystem in a short period of time. And it's very hard to predict the effects of that. And whether they can... Certainly, some species are going to lose out. Mm. They were a massive proportion of the bird population before. And also, that funding is being... There's a lot of concern that funding is detracted deflected from other conservation efforts and into people fantasizing about Jurassic Park.
I mean, it seems worth it for a dinosaur, doesn't it? But for pigeons, maybe not so much.
I imagine that like a DNA splicing scientist is different to a... Like, protect the animals and the environment kind of scientists.
Yeah.
So the responses from de-extinction activists and workers is essentially that, well, current conservation efforts are necessary, but they aren't really working, not least because people are tired of hearing every year that a new animal's gone extinct. They don't like bad news.
So they're just like, this is really good press to like bring animals back from the dead.
Good press. It's motivational because, like I said, if the habitat isn't there, then there's a fairly good chance that these animals aren't going to survive anyway. That a woolly mammoth isn't going to survive. So that work needs to be done too. That work is a necessary part of this work. And could be just good press for conservation.
The thing is, they're not thinking whether or not they should. They're just thinking about whether or not they could.
I think they're doing a little bit of both. What do you think? Should they?
Well, I don't want to get eaten on a toilet, so...
I mean, I can't help but think it sounds really cool. Like, I want to see dinosaurs and shit. And I kind of like the just creative aspect of it.
Nat wants to be eaten by a T-Rex whilst using an outhouse.
Yeah,
that's what we've heard. That's exactly what Nat is asking for then.
Their focus isn't really on dinosaurs. Partly,
well, that's the problem, isn't it?
Because it would be quite difficult to get usable DNA from dinosaurs, although I've not tried. I saw something like 100,000 years is the limit, but I don't really know, because you find stuff under ice. But, like, species that have gone extinct because of human interaction, I think, is the focus.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, like, if we're going to dedicate ourselves to fixing all of the species we've made extinct, we might be here for a while.
I mean, yeah, but my opinion basically is that it seems clearly silly to focus so much energy on trying to recreate a whole species, not just like individual animals, but recreate a species to fulfill an ecological niche. Like, we, you know, instead of focusing on the species that already exist.
Put a comment in the comments down below to tell us whether we're right or not.
How do you spell pigeon?